Welcome to the video lecture on design of a surplus wear. First of all, what is a surplus wear? So surplus wear, it is a structure which is constructed to release excess water from a tank or a reservoir, right? So the tanks are the smaller ones which we generally see in our villages. They are used to irrigate the lands, right? So generally the crust level of the weir, here you can see in the image, this is a crust level. That is, a crust level means the topmost level of the crust is provided at full tank level. So every tank, it has its upper limit, right? So it can store water up to certain limit. It can store water up to certain limit. So that limit, that is a safe limit that can store, that is a full tank level. So if the water goes above that, means if the discharge is more into the reservoir, then the excess water will go away from that surplus weir. So that is the purpose for which it is constructed. So see here, I kept a video of the model diagram. So I am playing it, which is the model in our laboratory we have, that is a surplus weir. So the middle one is a structure which is having a black color posts, right? So that is the main structure of the weir. See the arrangement of the wing walls and the return walls on either side of the embankment. That is the tank bund level. Main structure, stepper type of operand to discharge the water freely, erosion free, it will so the front view, and there was a joint, it is made up of two blocks are there. Now we see the different components. So before you design that structure, so what are the different components of it? You just see here the cross section is there. So this is the upstream side and this is the downstream side of the structure, right? So here the main structure, this is a weir wall. So I written this, I numbered this with the number 2, and an upstream side number 1 talus is there. So the purpose of providing talus is it reduces the seepage of water. It is made up of clay. And on downstream side, solid operand is there. It is numbered 3. It is a stepper type operand. The purpose of providing stepper type this operand is to reduce the erosion. If you do not provide this hard solid operand, ultimately the water will fall over. It has its energy. So because of that, the soil on the downstream side will erode away with water. So to avoid that, we have to provide this solid operon. And these structures are there. Number 4. Number 4, this structure is, this is a wing wall. So these wing walls and this abutment, so wing wall on upstream side number 4 and wing wall on downstream side number 6. And this return wall on upstream side and downstream side number 9 and 10. And this abutment, this is a tank bund, and structure 11. So these are made up with masonry or either with concrete. So these entire, this setup, that is wing walls and the return walls and the abutment, this will give the stability to the main structure, right? So that's why they generally these call as a protective works for the structure, right? And the 8th number, this is a embankment which is there. So here in the design, what we need, we have to design, means we have to find out the dimensions of the different components as per the requirement to pass the discharge safely from upstream to the downstream side. Yeah, that is our ultimate aim. So we have to estimate what is the length of the solid apron required, what is the top width and bottom width of the main wear wall, what is the height of the wear wall required, what is the thickness of the solid apron required, and what is the length of the solid apron up to this point, and how much splay you have to provide for the wing walls on downstream side and upstream side, right? So these are all the questions to us. So in this design, we are going to give the dimensions to the structure, right? So what is the depth of this post required? Solid stones. Here stones are provided. So if in case of urgency, if you want to store more amount of water, so in between the stone columns, there will be a gap. The water will flow here. But what we do is, we obstruct the flow of water with the sandbags up to the height of the stones, so that we can store water up to the top level of the stones. So that is the purpose for the stones are provided. But in generally, this is the top level, this is the crust level, up to this, this is the full tank level up to which the water will store in the reservoir. Right? So this structure we call it as surplus wear. In dams also we have a structure to release the excess water. That structure we call it as a spillway. Right? That is a spillway. So that is designed to pass a larger quantity of discharges, but it is a small structure for smaller tanks in our village reservoirs. Right? Next. See, these are the different components for which we have to give the dimensions. So first we see the components, how, what is the design criteria. So first we need to estimate the discharge Q. What is the discharge which is passing over the surplus wear? So it is Cm power 2 by 3. So here C is the runoff coefficient, and M is the catchment area. See, suppose one land area is there. This is one catchment. You take it as one catchment. So you have constructed a reservoir at this level, for example. You have constructed a reservoir and it is having a surplus wear at this position. At this position, surplus wear is there. So it's raining and water is storing up in the reservoir. So it has reached its ultimate capacity. Then whatever the rain, means whatever the inflow into the reservoir it is there, the total amount of water will come out from this surplus wear. So the inflow into the reservoir, that is the inflow from the catchment, whatever the runoff which is coming from the catchment, that whole runoff will go over this surplus wear. If the length of the surplus wear is not sufficient to discharge this discharge, then what will happen? Breaches in this earthen embankment will happen. So generally these embankments are constructed with earth, right? Soil material. So once if the overflow starts, then breaching will take place, then it flooded, means the downward area below it will get flooded ultimately. Right, so here M is the catchment area. Catchment area means from where the runoff is coming, the total area from where the water is coming into this particular reservoir. Okay, and C is the runoff coefficient, means for example, if it is a grassy land, right, then it will absorb some amount of water. Suppose 10 centimeter rainfall is there. 10 centimeter rainfall is there. This grass can absorb 5 centimeter of runoff, rainfall. Then 5 centimeter will be the runoff. So now the runoff coefficient will be 0.5. That is 5 by 10. 5 by 10 means what is the runoff divided by total input? 10. This amount of water is coming from this. So that is the runoff coefficient. So 0.5 is a 5 by 10, 1 by 2. So 0.5 is the runoff coefficient for this particular catchment. If it is a very hard stony area, then there won't be any infiltration from the kind of catchment, then the runoff coefficient will be 1. Means whatever be the inflow, that is a rainfall into that catchment, the whole runoff will be appeared as the discharge which is flow over it. Means whole amount will appear as a runoff. Whole amount of rainfall will appear as a runoff. So C will be 1 in that case. So a catchment will be made up of, means it is covered with different vegetative covers, agricultural lands, built up areas. So it depends on the catchment type, we have to calculate this runoff coefficient. Right, once if you know this, then Cm power 2 by 3, this is Rave's formula to determine the discharge which is flowing over the surplus wear. Next, so length of the surplus wear, it is designed based on the wear discharge through wear. Q is equal to 2/3 of L, CDL to 2 GH power 3 by 2. So here H is the depth of water. Here it is mentioned with S. So it is SRH. Here S means the shutter height. H is the depth of water which is flowing over. So here S is equal to H. So like that, Q, we know Q from this formula, and G, acceleration due to gravity, H is the depth of water which is flowing. How can you determine this H? It is depends upon the storage capacity. Full tank level, this is the full tank level, crush level is full tank level, and this is the water level. These two, maximum water level. Maximum water level minus full tank level will give us the depth of flow over the weir. Now, so like that we can calculate this length of the weir, total clear width of the weir from where the discharge will pass. Then crust width, that is the top width of the crust, is calculated based on this Bliss formula, that is 0.55 times of under root the height of this weir and the height of the depth of water which is flowing, under root H plus H, Bliss formula. And base width is calculated based on the stability analysis. You might know the stability analysis. So in stability analysis, the overturning moment is equal to the resisting moment. So here the overturning moment is due to the water which is standing behind the weir structure. Actually, if the water is standing up to this level, right, or maybe up to this level, ground level may be up to here. So sorry, this is the ground level. So above the water will be stored, but here also water is there in pores of soil. So this is the total head, right? So here, this is the total height of water which is standing. If you draw a pressure distribution diagram, it will be a triangular one. So due to this water, there will be a overturning moment on the structure, but its self weight can able to resist this overturning moment, right? So there is a stability analysis. So if you do stability analysis, you will get this kind of equation. Here this P is specific gravity of this masonry, whatever the material. Suppose if it is made up of the brick masonry, then you have to take the specific gravity of the brick. If it is made up of concrete, you have to take the specific gravity of the concrete. So P is specific gravity of the material with which the masonry made. H is height of the structure, wear structure. S is the height of the shutter. B is the base width of the structure. And A is top width of the wear structure. So here everything is known apart from this B. Here crust width can be calculated. This is A. So once if you know this A, B is unknown, right? So MR is equal to overturning moment. So MO is equal to H plus 6S whole cube by 6, right? So it will come as this total pressure force will act at a distance of H plus S by 3. If you see the hydraulic this fluid mechanics, the total pressure distribution, then the point at which it will act is H plus S by 3, and the total pressure will be to calculate H plus S square by 2. So if you take a moment about the heel, about this point, then the overturning moment must be equal to resisting moment. So MR is equal to M naught. So ultimately this B, that is the base width, can be calculated, right? And if chain of tanks present, there is one case. If chain of tanks means, suppose this is the total catchment area. So there may be different villages. I mean, in one catchment, there will be number of villages. So every one village has its own catchment, for example, like this. So this is own reservoirs. So here water is stored, here water is stored, here water is stored. So every tank has its own surplus weir. But see, this is the tank which is on downward. Suppose here it is the elevation, higher elevation, and here is the lower elevation in a catchment. Then if the water excess, if the excess flow of water comes from here, it will ultimately come to this reservoir, right? Reservoir 1. Suppose if it is reservoir 2, if the excess water comes from here, it comes to this reservoir, right? This is the crush level 3. Now suppose if like this, if different chain of tanks are present, then this discharge Q can be estimated by using this formula: C into m power 2 by 3 minus small c into m power 2 by 3. For example, if you want to design a surplus weir for the reservoir 3, that is surplus weir 3, then C is the runoff coefficient for the whole catchment. M is the total catchment area above this reservoir 3. C is, it is also runoff coefficient, it will be taken as some portion of C, right? Means we have to multiply with some coefficient, 0.5 or something is there, I will tell you. So multiply with C will give us small c value. Here M is the intercepted catchment area. Intercepted catchment area. Here intercepted catchment area means the catchment area above reservoir 2. So this is M. This is reservoir 3. What is the intercepted catchment area for the reservoir 3 and reservoir 2? This is the combined catchment area for the reservoir 2 and 3. Okay, it is a common one. So it is the intercepted catchment area. For example, if you want to design a weir for 2, then intercepted catchment area is up to the reservoir, the catchment area up to the reservoir 1. Right, so like that you have to calculate this intercepted catchment area, small m. So once if you know this, you have to take certain, you have to calculate Q, which is passing over this surplus weir 3. Right, so that is a small concept at this point. Next, abutments and wing walls. These must be designed as a retaining structure, right? Solid retaining structure. But for the time being, here some approximate dimensions can be provided, right? So as per this course, so if we do that complete work, it will be very complex. So it requires more time to complete the design procedure. So we will follow approximate procedure, means the formula to calculate the top width and bottom width of the abutments and that height. Okay, so abutment, so this is the central part of the abutment. So abutment, the front batter of the abutment means, suppose if you take the cross section, so here this is the rear side where soil is there, this is the front side, so this is 1:8 standard value. Top width and bottom width, so the top width, it is not required generally, but we go with 0.5 0.4 meter like that. But the bottom width will be designed as the total height of the abutment, right? Height divided by under root rho. Here rho is specific gravity of the abutment material. So height by rho will give us that. And similarly, the wing walls sloping downwards from abutments to return wall, so they will go down like this. And also it has splay, so this is called splay, and if you see in a vertical cross section, it has some sloping downward. So it is generally these wing walls follow the slope of the embankments, slope of the embankment, whatever it may be. And these play on upstream side and the downstream side. So generally five, one. This is 1 and 3, 1 in 3. So like that we follow. And these wing walls and return walls also having minimum top width and bottom width can be calculated based on height by row. Height can be calculated based on the foundation soil available. So you must take this abutment up to the hard strata. Wherever good foundation soil is available, you have to take up to that depth. So height can be determined like that. Rho is the material, whatever the material we use to construct that structure, the wing wall or abutment, whatever it may be, you have to take the rho, right? Next is solid aprons. So main is the design of the solid apron on downstream side. Why? Because I told you the solid aprons are provided to reduce the erosion, because whenever the water falls from the crust, so it possesses some energy, so it will fall directly under the soil surface. But to reduce it, what we provide some structure, one hard structure. This is called as apron. So providing apron on downstream side is very important, but on upstream side it is not required, but a minimum thickness and minimum length will be provided, right? And the total length of the apron is based on these failure conditions. Generally structures are failed based on these two criteria, due to piping action and due to uplift pressure. Piping means, so whenever water will seep from this place, means from the upstream floor level, and it will ultimately will go down to the downstream side, right? So these are the sheet piles or cutoff walls, we can say, right? So water will go, it will seep and it will come out from the downstream bed level. So if the hydraulic gradient, that is the if the seepage water having higher energy with it, and the soil material at this point is not able to hold that energy, then what will happen? This means effective stress. You might knowing this effective pressure. Suppose here the effective stress is zero, then what will happen? Boiling will take place. This water will, means this solid material will come out, and then what will happen? This solid material from upstream side will completely erode. So erosion will continue up to the top of the floor. Up to the top of the floor, the erosion will continue from the downstream side. That means the material will erode and it will form a pipe. To form a pipe so that the water will freely go in this and it will reach the downstream side. So this condition we call as piping. Now you see the porosity has increased on downstream of the structure, right? So its bearing capacity has reduced. That means ultimately the failure of structure takes place. So one kind of failure is piping failure, and another is due to uplift pressure. So whenever the seepage is taking place below the structure, so it tries to lift it up. Suppose if the weight of the structure is not sufficient to take this pressure which is coming from the seepage water, then it tries to lift it, means sliding will take place. The friction will not be sufficient, so ultimately failure will take place due to uplift. Net downward force will be lesser. Then this will push the water ultimately, means the thrust due to water. So it must be safe in piping and also due to uplift pressure. So there are two concepts. So if the structure must be safe in piping, so here you can see the total length is, means one theory is that Bliss creep theory. As per this theory, what it is he is saying is, if you provide this length, means from upstream to downstream, see, the water will pass alongside the solid. This is called a creep length. So water will seep through the impermeable strata, along the impermeable strata, that is the boundary. So the total length of creep will be, so here D1, it will come down and it will go up to a distance of D1, and will again it will travel horizontally for L1 distance, and it will travel vertically for D2 distance, and it will travel vertically for D2 distance. So like that, the total length of the creep is B plus 2 times of D1 plus D2 plus D3. So if you provide sufficient length, then the structure will be safe against piping. So that is what this Bliss creep theory says. So length should be such that it should be safe in piping. So there will be one term called hydraulic gradient, head loss, total head loss. This is the total head loss. This is the difference between the water level on upstream and downstream side. So divided by total length will give us the hydraulic gradient. Suppose, we'll see in the next table. Suppose if fine micaceous sand is present, then the safe hydraulic gradient is 1 in 15. Suppose if the calculated HL by L is greater than 1 by 15, then the failure of the effective stress will be 0. The material will be eroded, piping will take place. So that means the calculated hydraulic gradient by this formula must be less than these standard values. So these values are depends upon the type of the soil, sand, mud, right, coarse grain soil. You can see if the grain size increases, then hydraulic gradient will increase, right? So means it requires more amount of force to lift it up, right? So that's why, so it must be safe in hydraulic this piping, so that we have to design the length. Next, thickness due to uplift pressure, failure due to uplift pressure. Now the next case is, so now we have provided certain thickness. Is the thickness is sufficient or not? How can you determine? So first you have to draw this hydraulic gradient line. Here you can see one vertical line is there. So this line represents the hydraulic gradient line. You know what is hydraulic gradient means? Pressure head plus datum head. So here initially this level water is there. So we have drawn the hydraulic gradient line to the top of the floor, for example. You have drawn the hydraulic gradient line for the top of the floor. Then the water travels from this point and it will, the head is losing due to friction between the soil and the water. So head lost and it is traveling horizontally. That's why sudden drop is there. From this point, it will come up to this point. It will travel 2D1 distance, so sudden drop, and then a linear loss in head, and again cutoff wall is there, sudden drop, and again it is traveling horizontally, linear loss in head, and again cutoff is there, so it will rise. Ultimately, at this point, head loss will be zero. Right? Now you see, here vertical force is there and also downward force is there due to the standing water. So it will be safe even if you don't provide the apron. But if you come to this point, here only vertical force is there, just right side to this wall, then uplift pressure, here there is no weight downward, in downward direction only the uplift pressure is there, means here you have to provide sufficient thickness to safeguard against this uplift pressure. So the weight of the structure should be such that it must overcome this uplift force which is coming from the seeping water. So how it can be done? See here. one small relation. Uplift pressure will be gamma W into H dash. So here H dash is the hydraulic gradient distance. For example, I want the distance here. So from bottom of the flow to this top of the hydraulic gradient, this is the H dash. This is the residual head. This is the residual water head is remaining. Right? So from this point to, means from bottom of the floor to the top of the floor, that is H dash. So gamma W into the H dash will give us uplift pressure force. Then, so uplift pressure we have to multiply with the unit area. So unit area is 1. And downward pressure, what is the downward pressure? So it is due to the self weight of this. It is due to the self weight of this concrete or the material. So it will be gamma W into G. G is the specific gravity of the floor material that we use. It will give us specific gravity of the, sorry, unit weight of the material, multiply with the thickness, multiply with unit area will give us the downward pressure force. Here they said it is pressure, right? So if you multiply with 1, you will get pressure force. So for equilibrium, downward pressure must be equal to upward pressure. So gamma W into H dash is equal to gamma W GT minus 1 GT. So H dash is equal to GT. So if you subtract thickness on both sides, why we are subtracting is here H dash is from bottom of the floor. If you see, H dash is from bottom of the floor. This is the thickness of the floor. If you subtract thickness, you will get H. That is, you can directly calculate this hydraulic gradient above the floor level. That's why here we are doing subtract HT on both sides. Then GT minus T. So here if you see, H dash minus T is the residual head above the floor level, not from the bottom of the floor. It is hydraulic residual head remaining above the floor level. So thickness it is required is H by G minus 1. This is the formula we can use it. So that much thickness we have to provide. Then the apron will be safe in piping and also in uplift pressure. So like that we will design this structure. We'll see example for it. See example for it. So design the surplus work of a tank forming a part of chain of tanks. See here they given forming a part of chain of tanks. The combined catchment area is given. That is the total catchment area 25.89 square kilometers. And the intercepted catchment area is given 20.71 square kilometers. So it is decided to store water in the tank to a level of plus 12 meters above MSL. Up to what level we can store water? Plus 12 meters. That is the full tank level. It is saying from mean sea level. Okay. Mean sea level. We can say it is a reduced level. So limiting the submersion for foreshore lands up to a level of 12.75 meters above MSL. The general ground level at the proposed site is 11 meters and the ground level below the proposed surplus slopes off till it reaches 10 meters in about 6 meters. So from 11 meters to 10 meters, so it is sloping downwards, is in a distance of 6 meters. So the tank bund has a top width of 2 meters and level is given and its slopes are given on either side. It is 2:1 for tank bund. The tank bunds are designed for saturation gradient of 4:1 with 1 meter clear cover. Okay. So provision may be made to make kachya regulating arrangement to store water up to maximum water level at times of necessity. So here they said this is the maximum water level 12.75. So we have to, but water will store up to 12. But in case of necessity, water will go up to 12.75. So we have to provide the stones, right? The foundations are of hard gravel at level of 9.5. Up to 9.5 level, the hard stone is available, hard gravel is available. So this is the minimum data that is required to do the design. Now we will go one by one. See what they have given, areas are given. First we have to estimate, we have to design a surplus wear. First estimate the discharge. So Q is equal to, I told you, Cm power 2 by 3 minus Cm power 2 by 3, small cm. So here the C value will range from 6.8 to 15, that is capital C. So assume this C as 10 value, it is our wish. So it is based on experience actually. Then small c will be C by 5 to C by 3, this is the range I told you, right, some coefficient into C. So 1 by 5 to 1 by 3. So I am taking 1 by 5, that is the least value, then my structure will be in safe condition. I will estimate the maximum discharge. So I am taking 1 by 5th. And capital M combined catchment area is 25.89. Intercepted catchment area is 20.71. So if you just substitute these values and if you calculate, you will get 72.43 is the discharge which will pass through the surplus wear. Right? So for this discharge, right, so calculate the length of it. So Q is equal to 2/3 of CDL root 2G H power 3 by 2. So assume some CD value, take it as a broad pressured wear. So for wears, the CD value is will not go more than 7, right? Maximum it is 0.65 like that. But if you see some standard values, so here CD value will be 0.562 I am taking. And H, that is the maximum depth of water, it will be 12.75 is the maximum water level, and this is the full tank level, that is the crust level, okay, it is also crust level of the weir. See, this is the crust level, you can see. So maximum water level minus 50 L will give us the depth of water, that is a 0.75 meter. So Q is already known, 72.43, it is calculated in the previous slide. So just substitute these two, H and Q, and then if you calculate L, then L is 68 meters. So this is the clear width, between two abutments. But here we have to provide necessary arrangements to store water up to maximum water level, right? So stones have to provide. If you provide a stone of size 1.5 meter to 0.15 meter, means 150 mm by 150 mm size stone columns, then if you take 1 meter, total opening size 1 meter, means 68 number, means each opening is of 1 meter clear width. Here you can see 1 meter clear width between opening. So the total length of the weir will be 68 meters plus width of these stone columns, 67 multiply with 0.75. Number of openings, here you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 openings are there. How many posts are there? 1, 2, 3, 4 posts are there. So similarly, if 68 openings are there, then number of openings minus 1 will be the number of stones, 67. So 67 multiply with the width, right? So 78 meters total length from this point to this total H up to this level. Okay, then see crust width A. So here you can see the cross section of the weir, and levels are given plus 12.75 plus 12, and we don't know the bottom level of the crust. So here hard soil is available at 9.5 meter. So I am going just below that, some 0.5 or 4 meter. So I have taken 9.1 meter elevation MSL as a bottom level of this crust. So that's why I given 9.1 meter. And this concrete bed below the surplus wear, it is also a minimum thickness required is 0.6 meters. So the bottom level is 8.5 meter MSL. So see, from here H we determined already 0.75. So here it is H or S. H is 0.75 meter, capital H is 12 minus 9.1. So that is the total H, height of the weir. So it is 2.9 meter. So top width of the crust is, so if you substitute those values, it is 1.5 meters. Right? Next, base width of the weir. So for its stability, overturning moment is equal to resisting moment. And I have given you one value, one formula in the previous slides. So moment of overturning moment will be H plus S whole cube by 6. So it is 8.1045 kilonewton meter per meter width. Total length of the weir is there, but we are calculating for meter width, right? We are calculating the moment for meter width. That is meter length. Okay, meter length. Sorry. So that is 8.105 kilonewton meter per meter. Now see the formula for the moment of resistance. It is 1 by 12. So even you can do, if you are more fast enough, then you need to remember this formula. You just do the stability analysis, normal general procedure. Then also the procedure will be correct. No need to remember the formula in that case. So here the formula is there and every value is known. So take the specific gravity of the material as 2.25. Suppose if it is made up of masonry, we are not taking any RCC structure here. So then assume it is made up of masonry, then the specific gravity of the masonry is 2.25. Then follow this formula and substitute every value, right, except B. We don't know B. We have to calculate B here. And if you solve this equation for B, if you solve this equation for B, then here we got the B as 2.7 meters, and see the whole entire dimensions. Here some offset 0.3 meter is required. So total base width of the concrete bed is 3.3 meters, base width of the crust and top width of the crust. So everything is there in detail. These are the dimensions. Right, so crust is means the wear wall, surplus wear wall is designed along with its stone columns. Next, what are remaining? Abutments, wing walls and return walls. Right, now we'll see that. Abutments top width is 0.5 meter and bottom width is height by under root rho, I told you. So top width is 0.5 meter, minimum width is required. But you see, what is the top width of the abutment? I think it is given in the problem. Top width means the top level of the abutment is given in the problem. 14.05. And provide the bottom of the means the hard foundation is available at 9.5, but you take it up to 9.1. Means the foundation level for the whole structure, that is for the wear wall and also for the wing walls, return walls, is at plus 9.1 level. So the height of the structure will be 14.05 minus 9.1 divided by under root rho will give us the bottom width. Top width is calculated, bottom width is calculated, and its front battery is calculated. Now the minimum thickness for this is 0.6 meters and offset on either side is 0.3 meters and here also it is 0.3 meters. So abutment is over. Next, see the wing walls, upstream side and also on downstream side. So see upstream side, here will be splay. You can see at section B, the section of the wing wall. So where the wing wall is starting, it's section B. So the section of the wing wall and the abutment will be same. But if you see the bottom width of the abutment or these wing walls is depends upon the height of it. But now if you see here, it is sloping downwards. It is sloping downwards from 14.5 to up to this wing walls level. It is sloping down up to C. So this is the level wing wall we need to will provide, but it is sloping down from B to C, means 14.5 to some level at C. That means height of the wing wall is varying. That means base width also will vary because bottom width is depends upon H. So we have to calculate the bottom width at section C. Top width you keep it as 0.5 meter. See what is the elevation to calculate the bottom width. Elevation at C is required. So the maximum water level is 12.75. So these wing walls are provided just above the elevation of the maximum water level. This is the maximum water level. Plus you keep it as 0.3 or 0.5, no problem. So here I taken 0.3. Some free body is required. So 0.3 I have provided so that the water will not come and touch the embankment. Right? So some safe limit 0.3. So it is 13.05. So the total height of this wing wall at section C is 3.95 meter. So the bottom width is 3.95 divided by the specific weight, means specific gravity 2.25. So it is 2.7 meter. So section of level wing and return wall. So here the level wing and return wall. This is the level, means it is having constant elevation. It is having constant elevation of 13.05 from section C. From section C, its elevation is 13.05. It is having equal RL. Right? So that means the height of the wing wall and return walls from section C is constant. That means from section C, the cross section is constant to E. At C, at D, and also at E, the cross section is constant. So that's why section of level wing and return wall both are same. Section of level wing and return wall is 0.5 meter by, base width is 2.7 meter, front batter 1:8. So its elevation we know. So everything we know from here. Offset 0.3 meters. Foundation level it is 9.1. This is plus 9.1 minus 0.6, 8.5. So like that. So that is up to the upstream, and come to the downstream. So downstream, this level, this wing wall will go up to the ground level, up to the ground level. Means from this point to this point, it is having sloping wing wall. So the cross section varies up to F. Cross section is varies linearly from A to F. From A to F, the cross section varies. Right? So here at F, elevation is ground level, that is 11 meters. So the base width will be total height, that is 11 minus 9.5, that is the foundation level. 11 minus 9.5 divided by under root rho will give us the base width at F, that is equal to base width at G also. The cross section is constant. Right? So cross section at F and G is constant. So base width, top width, and the batters are known. Next thing is aprons on downstream side. I told you. So how we have to design the aprons? Basically, it should be safe against piping and also safe against uplift pressure. So first we will check the hydraulic gradient. Here in the problem, I think the hydraulic gradient given is 1:5. Suppose if it is not given, you can assume this value. You assume certain type of soil and take the hydraulic gradient as 1:5. Okay. Suppose if hydraulic gradient is 1:5. In the problem, right? So it is given that the elevation is changing from at site, the ground level is 11. But on downstream side, it is changing the elevation within a distance of 6 meters. Within a distance of 6 meters, the elevation is changing. So we can provide either a stepper type of apron. It is a stepper type of apron. Two steps are there. But also you can also provide the sloping type of apron. That is your wish. Here I am going with the stepper type of apron. So the energy dissipation will be effective in this case. Right? Because the water will fall, so there will be efficiency of energy dissipation will be higher. Right? So here, what is the length? Length, that is a creep length required, is HL into 5. This much length is required. HL is the head loss. Suppose if water is stored up to this level, then what is the head loss? 12.75 minus 10. And downstream side there is no water. There is no water. That means 12.75 minus 10 will give us the total head lost, that is 2.75 meter. So to be safe in piping, you must have to provide this much creep length, HL into 5. So the total creep length required is 13.75. That means from A to F, suppose if you take this red line as creep length, actually the creep length must follow this impermeable one. But to be in a safer side, I am taking this red line as the creep length. Okay, that is A, B, C, D, E, F. So it must be equal to 13.75 meters. Now we know what is AC and what is CD. We have to find out this DE value. That is our question. Right? Now we see here creep length as per Bliss theory required is AB plus BC plus CD. Right? DE plus EF. EF is, this is the EF. Now it is 13.75 meter. So here we don't know what is DE. What is DE, we don't know. Then calculate this DE value. DE value. Right, here DE is equal to 7 meters we got. Here EF, here we taken the bottom line is 8.5, that is EF is equal to 10 minus 8.5. Okay, so total length of DE required is 7 meters. So I am providing two steps. So I will provide two halves. So up to the first step, 3.5 meter of solid apron. So it is having greater thickness of apron, but after 3.5, the thickness has reduced because uplift pressure reduces, right? If you go from upstream to downstream side, so the residual uplift pressure will reduce continuously. So that's why the maximum thickness is provided for the upper 3.5 meters, and for the remaining part, less than thickness T is provided. Okay, so this is the DE length required, 7 meters. Now next is thickness of the solid apron. Thickness of the solid apron, how much it is required. So first assume 1 meter, see, 1 meter of thickness at this D. Actually you have to take this point as at this place, but I am taking here itself, I am neglecting this distance. Okay, so provided creep length, so how much total creep length you have provided is 2.5, 3.3, 7 meter and 1.5 meter, 14.7 meters we have provided, because DE we have calculated is 7 meters, so total length is 14.3. Now hydraulic gradient will be head loss per unit length. So total head loss we know it is 2.75 divided by this creep length will give us the hydraulic gradient, 1 in 5.2. Now you see, what is the head lost up to point D? So the total head D is 2.75. While it is traveling from A to F, it is losing its head. That means at D the head loss is less than 2.75. At E it further reduces. At F it will be zero. So what is the head loss up to D? That is, we know 1 in 5.2 means it is 1 meter is head is losing for every 5.2 meter creep length. 1 meter of head is losing for every 5.2 meter of creep length. That means we know this 1/5/2. So what is the creep length up to point D? AC plus CD means AB plus BC plus CD, 2.5 plus 3.3 plus 1.5. This is the creep length up to point D. Then if you multiply with the hydraulic gradient, it gives you what is the head lost up to D. That is 1.403 meters of head of water lost. Now what is the residual head? So total head is 2.75, the residual head is 1.405. So the residual head is 1.347 meter. This much head is remaining at this point D. Why we are calculating residual head at D? Because I told you previously, on upstream side there is water. So this uplift pressure, suppose if you take here uplift pressure, this uplift pressure will be counterbalanced by the self weight of the structure, self weight of this weir structure. But if you come here, there is nothing, only soil is there. But now we want to provide apron, 1 meter thickness we have assumed. Okay, so that's why I have calculated this uplift pressure at D. Now see, this is a residual head. Now take concrete, it is having some thickness T, pressure is equal to gamma W into H. So uplift pressure is equal to, that means uplift force is equal to weight of the concrete. Weight of the concrete means to be in a safe condition, it must be equal to weight of the concrete. Suppose if you take unit area, now see what is the uplift force, that is 9.81 gamma W into residual head, this is H. Okay, means residual head at bottom of the floor, that is 1.347 into H multiply with weight of the concrete, 24 multiply with area into thickness, volume. So here thickness is 0.55 meter. So provide some extra to be in safe side. So provide 20% of extra thickness. So it will be 1.2 multiplied with 0.55, so 0.66. But we have provided 1 meter. So, but we can, what the thickness required? 0.6 meter thickness is sufficient. That means we are in safe condition. And also we can use the other formula, that thickness is equal to h by g minus 1. We have seen thickness is equal to h by g minus 1. So here h means the residual head which is remaining at this point. So we have to calculate the residual head at this point instead of d. That means we have to calculate additional creep length. This is 11, so this is 8.5. So 11 minus 8.5, that is here this 1.5 will replace with 2.5. So replace with 2.5, and then we can use the same formula. Then we can eliminate this procedure. Then we can use this formula to calculate this thickness. Thickness of solid apron. Then provide 20% of extra. Right? Now we see this is the ultimate design for the solid apron on downstream side. 3.5 meters and this is 1 meter. So for the remaining 3.5 meters, so this is the remaining 3.5 meters. 0.5 of the this thickness, 1.5 meter is sufficient. So 0.5 meter is sufficient, and on downstream side provide pitching, stone pitching with 50 centimeters or 0.45 meter or 0.5 meter thickness boulders for a length of 3 meters or 2.5 meter, right? It is sufficient for bed pitching. Right? Next, the upstream side apron. Upstream side apron. Apron is not required, I told you, but we provide puddle clay filling. Puddle clay filling on upstream side just reduces the seepage. That's it. Nothing requirement is there. That means here we will remove the general soil, means the natural soil which is there in the site. So we will remove it and we will fill up that portion with puddle clay with 1:1 slope up to the bottom of this hard soil. Right? See. So after designing the structure, now we have each and every dimension. Then by having the image of the structure, how it looks like from the bottom, how it looks like from the top, how the cross section, if you cut it along the weir, how it appears. If you see from the front view, its elevation, how it appears. Right? And if you cut across the weir section and how it appears. If you see from this view, from right, how it appears. So if you, after you having all the dimensions and having this imagination, right? So then we will go for the drawing. So then for the drawing, first we have to plan the sheet. We have the dimensions. So according to the sheet, first we have to fix one scale. And then you will start drawing from drawing the center line of the structure. First you have to take the center line of the structure, and from here you will start the bottom width, and then what will appear. This is the bottom plan. This is the top plan. So in the bottom plan you can able to see the bottom widths, so how they appear, and we already told you the splays. So like that, one by one you have to draw from sequence, but you have to start from the center line. And you must know the boundaries. That means you have to fix up the total length and total width based on scale and fix its position in the drawing. For example, whatever you are watching, the screen, white screen, it is a total drawing sheet. So before going to the drawing, you must fix what is the total length is required and what is the total width is required to draw this bottom and top plan. And come to the section, longitudinal section and longitudinal elevation. If you cut across this portion and if you look in this direction, right? So this is up to cross section, but this is the elevation. Elevation means you can see here. We are drawing only of longitudinal section of elevation, because it is similar, right, on both sides, so it is sufficient. So here also, first you have to fix the top line and the bottom lines, then from here you take the projections for each and every structure, then these remaining lines will be fixed. First you fix the top and bottom lines based on the elevations. Similarly, if you cut a section across the weir, then how it appears, if you see, if you look in this direction, how it appears. So the section cutting the wing wall, that means you can able to see the material, but it is not this is the weir wall, that means you can able to see the material, but it is not cutting the wing walls. That's why just you can able to see the boundaries of the wing wall, but here the dashed lines are there. These are the foundation lines. Dashed lines are foundation line. It is cutting the apron. I showed you in the video how the apron looks like. Right? So wherever it is cutting, you have to show the material. But if it is not cutting, just you have to show the boundaries of it. What you can able to see there. Right? So this is also starts from the center line. First take a center line and fix the top and bottommost lines, and you come from the bottom. Take the projections for each and every line, and then you have to connect based on these elevations one by one. Then you will can able to draw this diagram for the cross section. So you have to show it in a diametrical way, so that these drawings will be communicated with the people who are there in the site to execute the work, right? It is our language, right? Engineering language. So whatever you have designed, you must show it in a diagrammatical format, right? So this is the end of this video. So thank you for watching it.